Water is the most ancient form of transport. Before there were roads, there were rivers. Before man-made railways, he channeled water across land. Some of these trade routes are still with us. One of the greatest and most imaginative makes a voyage between two seas.
I'm on board the Mersey ferry Highland Seabird. Out there on the port bow is the Irish Sea. Over there ahead of us, the Lancashire coastline. I was born in Lancashire, and that's a coastline I know pretty well. As a kid, it seems every holiday was spent paddling in the Irish Sea. We're going to take you from here to the North Sea, all the way on water. Yes, it can be done, thanks to the imagination and foresight of two 18th century Yorkshiremen, John Longbotham and John Hustler, who had a dream to unite the two seas.
The Highland Seabird is fine for the River Mersey. She'd be no use at all on the Leeds and Liverpool Canal. Today, the skipper's eye view of the Liverpool waterfront is very different from the 18th century. Now the Liver building dominates the skyline. In the days of the sailing clippers, it was this six-sided clock tower. Salisbury Tower marks the beginning and the end of the Leeds and Liverpool Canal. When the canal was opened, the cargo was mainly cotton. It travelled in barges like Juno, a typical Leeds and Liverpool wide boat. Now the most popular canal craft are rather different. This is the narrowboat, the Lady Galadriel. She's going to take us on the first stage of our journey. Note the literary reference. If you know your Tolkien, you'll know the name. She's under the charge of her skipper, Stuart Sampson. Morning, Stuart.
Good morning.
Are we set?
Yes, we're set to go. If it looks like to go up and cast off for it.
Right. Salisbury Dock was and still is the terminal point of the longest inland waterway in Britain. There are 127 and a quarter miles of it, 95 and a quarter miles more than all the canals of Venice put together. In Venice, the canals link sea with sea. Here at Salisbury Dock, the tidal River Mersey laps one side of the dock wall, while on the other side, the non-tidal basin forms the man-made lagoon that's the beginning of the canal. The word lagoon conjures up visions of pleasure cruising through exotic scenery. But when you travel by water through Liverpool's dockland, you travel through industrial history.
It's great to be up, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Here is all the evidence that the cargo on the Leeds and Liverpool wasn't just cotton. There was sugar, rum, coal, and tobacco. Under the Regent Road swing bridge in Stanley Dock, the canal begins its journey out of the industrial Liverpool it helped to create. 100 years ago, Jess Hartley's tobacco warehouse was the biggest in the world. It even had an incinerator chimney where they burnt the tons of tobacco the importer couldn't pay duty on. Hartley's warehouse is still in use, but not for tobacco. Now it's wines and spirits that are kept in bond. Today, the first 8 miles of the inner city stretch of the canal is classified as a remainder waterway. It's rarely navigated.
Amazing.
This is where we begin our climb, away from sea level and out of the city. The locks enable us to do it. Close the gates on one level, then fill the lock with water. These locks were designed for the wide boat, the most economical method of transporting goods from one place to another.
Because it's going to bounce about a fair bit.
Why is it
going to be bouncing?
Because of the water's coming in. They've opened both the top paddles. And because we're only a narrow boat in a wide lock, we tend to rattle about a good bit.
Yeah.
The canal was built for industry. Now industry has all but hidden it. Canals are shy creatures. They tend to hide away behind factory walls, down side streets, under bridges. If you look for them from land, they take some finding. When you do find the canal today, it's difficult to imagine that it wasn't only trade that plied the Leeds and Liverpool, but people. This murky stretch of weedy water was once the motorway of its day, where the packet boats, the passenger boats, had right of way. Once a year, this green belt of land becomes the most famous steeplechase course in the world. Today, you have to stand on the roof of the boat to see Aintree. It was fenced off in the 1950s, the heyday of cinema newsreels, after a barge, supposedly laden with hay, had made a pirate film of the Grand National. Every year, the directors of the canal took to the water, where they sat in a spectator's box mounted on a mud hopper. This stretch of tranquil water is known throughout the racing world.
They race down towards the canal turn. Red round from Churchtown Boy, and what a buck, then Happy Ranger. And behind that is the Pill Garlic and Sagani. That's Red round, just the canal turn.
By the time you get to the rural areas, the atmosphere's changed. So's the workload. At the time that these bridges were built in the 18th century, the engineers thought that they would save money by building structures like these. Over the years, it must have cost them far more in maintenance than it would have cost to build a permanent structure. There are 54 swing bridges, like this one, between Liverpool and Leeds. That's a lot of swing bridge. Can you go back a bit, please? Thanks. The chances are that any man who worked the Leeds and Liverpool Canal would know his horses pretty well. The canal predates the steam engine and it predates the diesel. The canal was built for the horse. And here at Latham Locks on the Rufford branch of the canal is a bridge that was built for the horse.
See how the cross struts of millstone grit are built into the towpath to aid the horse's grip. We're bound straight ahead for Wigan, but if the load was bound for Preston and the Ribble estuary, the tow line would have to be hauled below the bridge before the convoy set off again through the firelock gates and up the little River Douglas, first made navigable well before the canal age. Latham Locks is historically interesting. This little huddle of houses wouldn't exist if it wasn't for the canal. It's one of the first examples of a canal settlement. At one time it had everything, stabling, victualling, and it still has the dry dock in which the wide boats were berthed, tarred, and repaired. The Leeds and Liverpool wouldn't exist if it wasn't for Wigan. The whole concept behind the cut was to make it possible to carry away the Wigan coal and bring in cotton. Passengers came later. By the 19th century, the packet boats were the expresses. Speeds of up to 9 miles an hour were not unknown, more than twice the speed of the Lady Galadriel. Horses were changed every 5 miles, and the good horsemen expected the change to take under 30 seconds. Since the days of the packet boats, this 40-foot platform of stone has passed into literary history and into folklore. It was George Formby's father, George Formby Sr., who made it into a national joke, and it was George Orwell who gave the joke more substance when he chose it as his symbol of 1930s depression. This is Wigan Pier. Even today, the mention of its name is enough to raise a smile or two, but it does exist. It might not be what you thought it was. A few yards from the pier, the Leeds and Liverpool warehouse with its twin arches above the water. Renovation has begun, and it's hoped that other canal side buildings will also be restored. For 36 years, Wigan was the terminal point of the Leeds and Liverpool. It took over 40 years and cost £1.2 million to complete the cut to Leeds. But even then, the work didn't stop. In 1820, the canal company built a branch to open up the route to the south.
That signpost marks the Lee branch of the canal. Lee was my hometown. As a lad, I used to play on the banks of the canal down there. It was a grimy industrial landscape full of factory chimneys and pithead wheels. But there were one or two deep cuts where the canal passed between high banks on either side. And if I kept my head down, I couldn't see the rows and rows of factory chimneys that told me it was Lancashire. I used to pretend I was somewhere else.
It's here, just east of Wigan, that we start to climb the Pennine foothills. Already we've passed through 21 locks since leaving the port of Liverpool. Now there are another 23 which lift us mechanically over 250 feet in a space of just 3 miles. That's the hell of a hill for a hill of water. Only halfway up the hill and already we're higher than the rooftops and the church. It takes us half a day to climb this staircase up the Pennines. Since the 1960s, I've done the journey from Lancashire into Yorkshire countless times. I've done it by motorbike, done it by car, even walked and climbed it once. But I've never, ever done it by water. Fortunately, climbing locks is relieved by the number of waterside hostelries which dot the Leeds and Liverpool.
Stuart?
Oh, thanks very much.
Cheers.
Cheers.
I think we deserve this.
Yeah, we've got 27 locks now. No, 28 since Wigan.
Not bad.
Got a 10-mile stretch now without any locks until Blackburn.
10-mile stretch of lock-free water.
Great. Looking forward to that.
After passing the top lock at Johnson's Hillock, we've climbed 350 feet above the sea. Difficult to imagine that we're halfway between Wigan and Blackburn, two of the most industrialised conurbations in Lancashire. Like the child who brags about its age in fractions,
I'm 10 1/4, I'm 10 3/4,
the Leeds and Liverpool is proud of its length. Every milestone brags about that extra quarter of a mile. We're high in the Pennines, but something's missing. Perhaps it's right that it should rain. Somehow the blue slate roofs of Blackburn, Lancashire, are more evocative, wet than dry. It was the coming of water which heralded the Industrial Revolution. When the canal opened, Blackburn's population was under 10,000. Today it tops the 100,000 mark, and the whole reach of the canal is glazed with oil. From Coronation Street to Rishton, it's like sailing down a rainbow. By the time we've worked through Blackburn, we've climbed higher. Even so, the humpback lump of Pendle Hill hangs above us. Pendle was a notorious place for witches and witch hunts. 19 of them stood trial in 1612. 9 of them were hanged. The work of the witches was as mysterious as the mason's marks on Gano Tunnel. 559 yards of murky black. At the time the Gano Tunnel was built, witches and witchcraft were still in living memory. But by that time, the spells of the Pendle witches were as difficult to decipher as the mason's marks today.
Flibbity, gibbity, flasty plum, Califat, Tarada, Wagra Wam, Hookie, Maruki, whatever's the sum. Out shall go darkness, and light shall come.
The Leeds and Liverpool Canal was the main service duct to the factories of the Industrial Revolution. Once this navigation was frantically busy, awash with boats, and so the new factories turned their backs on the scene, preferring instead to face the new, then peaceful, turnpike road. The fact that the buildings turn their backs on the canal tends to give the impression that the canal is ignored. But in Burnley, there are signs that the town is taking notice. The Manchester Road Wharf was built in 1840. Today, the protective canopy above the water has been restored to its original condition. Underneath the canopy, susceptible cargoes like grain used to be unloaded under cover. it's right that Burnley should take note of its canal, because it's in Burnley that we find one of the seven wonders of the waterway. The Straight Mile, a 60-foot-high artificial embankment built from the spoils of Gano. That witch's tunnel we passed through 100 yards back provided the earth for this railway-style embankment across the Burnley Valley. But all this was a long time before the age of steam. In fact, the Straight Mile is 3/4 of a mile in length, and not a mile at all. Thanks to the embankment, there's not a lock in sight for 23 miles. Imagine what that could mean. If something somehow breached that bank, 23 miles of water would fill Burnley. That was a worry in World War II. How could the citizens of Burnley sleep peacefully in their beds with the chance of a German air raid breaching the canal? One direct hit and the town would be washed away. Safety measures were called for. Each night after the day's canal traffic had passed through the town, the engineers would lower stop planks into the narrows between the bridges. That way, if there was a breach, they'd only lose a length of water instead of 23 miles of it. Come nearly 80 miles since leaving the sea in Liverpool, and we've climbed to a height of around 500 feet, way up in the Pennines. We haven't yet reached Yorkshire, the home of John Longbotham and John Hustler, the 18th century pioneers whose imagination and enterprise made possible the voyage between two seas.